These practices are inspired by the life of the Prophet of Islam and his companions. They withdraw from society temporarily approved by Islamic law as a measure to save themselves from the corruption and degeneration of the government and society. I say temporarily because I will explain this later. The Sufi mystical occupation of devotion and remembrance of God, dhikr, which I will explain again, and constant contemplation, tafakkur, has been applauded and praised by the Sunnah, by the example of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and all the concepts of Sufi philosophy are suggested by and grounded in the different Quranic verses and hadiths. Allow me to be a really boring academic for 10 minutes only. I promise you in the Q&A session I will entertain you as much as I can, as a Turkish scholar. But I really would like to get the message across how Sufism, even though it's up for benefit for everybody, but in itself is deeply rooted in the teachings of Quran and in the example of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And not only that, all the great Sufi masters of Islamic history, such as Junayd Baghdadi, Al-Ghazali, or Ibn Arabi, or Rumi, or Jailani, or Naqshbandi. Who doesn't know Rumi in this room? Who absolutely have no clue who that person is? Okay. How many people in this room, before I go further in my talk, have been exposed to at least some aspect of Sufism? Either the teachings, or some practices, some dhikr sessions, some dhikr falakas. Can I see the hands? How many people have enrolled? Good. So, I can speak Sufism 102 then. I don't have to go through all one by one. These great Sufi scholars whom we basically benefit and enrich our spiritual life today, they are nothing but the great scholars of Islam and devoted pious practicing Muslims. Let's see one of the founding fathers of Sufism, Junayd al-Baghdadi, says in his invitation to people to Sufism, he says, our science, Sufism, is built on the solid foundation of the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ. He who has not memorized the Quran, who he has not does not live the Hadith, and does not concern himself with the law, Islamic law, he cannot be considered as a practitioner of our science. I don't necessarily take his invitation literally, and I disagree with him to limiting to practice Sufism, understanding Sufism to necessarily only Muslims. But no doubt he is one of the founding fathers of Sufism. No doubt he basically established the major doctrines and practices of Sufism, which all the tariqats, the Sufi orders, are now based upon. But he basically says your departure point should be the Holy Quran and the example of the Prophet Muhammad. If you don't start from there, basically you will end up finding it's only very artificial, literal meanings of certain Sufi doctrines and methods. Sufism is the spiritual life of Islam. Those who represent Islam according to the way of the Prophet and his companions have never stepped outside of the boundary. A tariqa, a Sufi order, is an institution that reaches the essence of religion within the framework of Sufism and gaining God's approval, thus enabling people to achieve happiness both in this world and the world to come. So I would like to really challenge the whole idea, the whole attempt to draw or picture Sufism something completely different or free or independent from any organized religion, but especially Islam. For Sufis, as for all Muslims, the Quran is the fundamental guide in their life. Quran is their GPS. Before they conduct the Sufi journey, the address that they use, the compass that they use, the navigator that they use, is the Quran, in the matters of especially religion and faith. What may be distinguished Sufis from other Muslims lies largely in the way they interpret this divinely sent guide. Sufis, in addition to understanding the literal meaning of the Quran, they advocate and emphasize more, because Quran itself says it has many, many, many meanings, multi-layers of meanings. And the Sufis advocate more about the allegorical, metaphorical interpretation of the Quran, believing that mystical meanings, some symbolic meanings of the Holy Quran, this revelation to humanity, as they believe, is concealed beneath its literal meaning. That it has been concealed or veiled for a purpose behind its symbolic language. Sufis believe that in order to discover these symbolic meanings, one must be able to read the Quran with the eye of heart. Sufis, mystics, believe that in order to discover these symbolic meanings of the divine revelation, one must be able to read the Quran and the universe and the creation with the eye of the heart. There is nothing more central to Sufi teachings than the eye of the heart. So allow me to spend a little bit more time on this. I will go through the other aspects of Sufism really quickly. Not only with the eyes of head, because Sufis believe that if you would like to see the fingerprint of God in your life, if you would like to experience and feel the presence of God in your life, you have to make sure you have a heart, you have an eye in your heart. And you are able to see through the eye of your heart, not only with the flesh. Because in the most striking, beautiful way, in the most significant, transforming and changing way, the fingerprint of God cannot be seen with this flesh eyes. It can only be seen with the eye of the soul or with the eye of the heart. This basic and very fundamental concept of eye of the heart, eye, E-Y-E, is basically mentioned in the Quran in Surah 6, in chapter 6, verses from 103 to 106. The God says, there is no God but God, the creator of all things. So worship God alone. God is the guardian of everything. No physical eyes can comprehend him, and he comprehends all visions. God is the subtle and aware. Now, there have come to you clear proofs and signs from your Lord to open your eyes. Therefore, anyone who will open his eyes or her eyes, it is for his own good. And therefore, whoever plays blind, it is for his or her own harm. The term eye of the heart is a metaphor for insight, the ability to see and understand clearly the inner nature and meanings of things. It is, however, a particular kind of insight, one wholly dependent on the divine inspiration. In many Sufi writings, this term, the eye of the heart, has been commonly defined as a power of sight illuminated by a divine light. Among the verses of the Quran, which they cite in support of this idea, is the from chapter 14, verse 35, light upon light. God guides his light whom he will, and God speaks to human beings in allegories, in symbols, for God is the knower of all things. I think nothing is, as I said, is more central to Sufism and the mystical understanding of Islam than exploring your ability to see through your soul, through your heart, and having your improving ability to see through the eye of the heart. The practices which comprise the basis of the Sufi way of life is geared toward making this eye more open and receptive to divine illumination, to divine fingerprints and signs in our lives. Sufis have long regarded after the eye of the heart, the second concept, the second very central Sufi doctrine, the Sufis, like many Muslims and many others, they regard arrogance as the greatest sin of all. They regard arrogance and pride as the biggest obstacle for you to reach God, to the divine in your life. They recognize that arrogance stems from the great pleasure that man takes his own accomplishments. Human beings are self-sustained. They can rely on themselves and they can accomplish things all by their own. They also recognize that this pleasure of self-sustenance, this imaginary delusion, never more intense when these accomplishments earn